As you can see, this is more of a coloring lesson than a drawing lesson. And also, as you can see, this would be really difficult to draw on your own. I thought this was a little bit too complex to just have you draw from scratch. And coloring is also a standard activity used in high school and in college science classes. There's a whole series of coloring textbooks that are designed for college level. So it's okay to do a bit of coloring. Since we're going to be doing a lot of coloring, I would advise that you make sure your pencils are sharp. Some of these little areas are going to be kind of small to get into, so you might want to take a few minutes and make sure your pencils have a nice fresh point on them. So this drawing represents tissue in the central nervous system, and specifically in the brain. You would find these cells probably in the spinal cord also, but this is specifically a slice of brain. Now, if you actually looked at a slice of brain like this, or like this, okay, you're not really going to be very impressed. It's really hard to tell what you're looking at. We'll see some pictures later on that are a little bit better than that, where they focus in on a particular cell. But it's really hard to tell from these pictures what the cells look like. So, of course, that's why artists are hired to do things like this, which is very exciting and colorful. And this, which is very easy to understand. So let's start with the neuron, since we're already familiar with it. You can see a large soma here with dendrites going off, and of course this blank area will be for you to fill in nucleus and ER, those parts inside. And down here we have the axon. It looks like Schwann cells. They're connected to this thing. We'll find out what those are in a minute. Axon terminals running down here off the page. And then we have another neuron coming up from the bottom. You can't see the soma. Here's the axon coming up, and there's all the little axon terminals here. And then there's another axon running on the page up here, like this, coming off. So we really only have one full neuron and two little bits of neuron. So all the rest of the stuff on the page is not neuron. And this correctly gives us the impression that most of the cells in the brain are not neurons. In fact, neurons are outnumbered 10 to 1 by these other cells. So all these other cells are called neuroglia, and they do various supporting functions. So let's start with this neuron here. I'm going to zoom in on the soma, and we'll start right here. I'm going to make this neuron green. I recommend that you make it green. I'm using kind of a light green, kind of a middle, I don't know, not super light, dark enough to look like it's a nice bright color, but not too dark. Kind of a spring green. So I'm going to just sort of find the dendrites first. So if you go out from the cell body, now we're going to fill this in a minute. We're going to put in the nucleus and everything. So just go around the outside. Don't fill this all in. Just kind of go around the outside and find all the dendrites. So this is kind of like a pop quiz for you. By this time, you've been drawing cells so much in all these modules, you should be able to fill this in with no help. So if you want to do that, you can pause the video, fill it in, and then quickly watch me do it and kind of check. But if you want to draw along with me, that's fine. You can do that too. So first, let's put in the nucleus. And of course, in the nucleus is the DNA. And most of the time, it looks like spaghetti. It only looks like chromosomes, those little sticks, when it's going through mitosis. And in this case, there's not going to be any mitosis going on. Neurons are one of the cells in the body that pretty much never does mitosis. Okay, you can make a dark spot if you want to for the nucleolus. Now, having said that, they used to tell everybody neurons never reproduce, you never regrow neurons. You're born with the number of neurons you're going to have for your whole life. Now they're finding that's kind of true, but not completely true. There are some stem cells that can grow to be new neurons to repair damage, mostly. However, it's still pretty true that you basically don't grow new neurons and that they do not do mitosis. Okay, so we need to put some endoplasmic reticulum outside of here. I'm just going to make a squiggly line. Don't spend too long making it. This is going to be rough ER, so I'm going to put ribosomes around it. This actually isn't specifically a neuron interior. It's kind of like any body cell. Let's give it some smooth ER over here. And what other organelles do we have? We've got mitochondria. And remember, we talked about having them down here. A bunch of them that are going to go down, travel down the axon. Remember how they travel up and down? And then they would, when they're broken, they might come back here. We'll make a lysosome to digest the old ones. So I've got some mitochondria, some lysosomes. How about Golgi bodies? Let's go stack of pancakes here. Remember, Golgi bodies are always kind of associated with that rough ER kind of close by. Let's see what else. I think I'll make a few more mitochondria. And there might be some little tiny storage vesicles floating around here. And some little peroxisomes and small things like that. Okay, and then you can take your green if you want to and just fill in a little bit around there. So if you're going very lightly, it's easier to fill in. If it's not perfect, you really don't notice. Okay, so let's go down here and find little bits of neuron peeking through, like right here. There's a bit of the axon peeking through. Right there, right there. And of course, it's covered by these things. And we learned about the Schwann cells in previous lessons. And you might guess, oh yeah, they're Schwann cells. They kind of look like it, but they have got this thing sticking off. And they're attached to another cell. It looks like it's a cell that has hands reaching out and grabbing the axon, wrapping its wrapper hands around the axon, and that's exactly what's going on. I'll talk about that in just a minute. Let's find the rest of the axon. It comes out here and goes down off the page to its terminal buttons or axon terminals or whatever you want to call those. Okay, so that is that neuron. Now, if we go up here, let's go to the upper left corner, we can see the bottom of a neuron peeking out here. We've got some axon terminals. And so look right here, what's happening. This axon terminal is coming very close to this dendrite. And we're going to see in the next lesson what's going on there. Here's another one that's coming very close to a dendrite. Now, it doesn't have anything next to it. This one already has some little insulators around it, holding it. This one's open, but it'll get grabbed by another cell pretty soon. All right, and here's another case down here where we have an axon terminal coming very close to some dendrites, and we have this cell reaching over and kind of holding it, and this cell over here is holding this side, so they're holding this in place so these can't slip apart. And we'll talk about that in a minute when we talk about this cell. Okay, so right now let's find all the rest of the neurons. So if we go over here, there's some axon terminals right here. Again, we've got an axon terminal coming very close to some dendrites, and we have these pads kind of holding it in place. And over here, those are supposed to be dendrites sticking onto the page. And we've got a little bit of axon peeking through there. And maybe this down here, I think maybe I intended this to be a little bit of a axon terminal. So on this whole page, that's it for neurons. Now before we go on to another cell, here's something important. Down here, this is the key. You see it says neurons, and then in parentheses it has a little summary of kind of what that cell does. Neurons transmit electrical impulses. So make some green right in front of the word neuron. Make a green dot so that you know that everywhere that's green is a neuron. Next, let's do those cells that are holding on here, right? Let's make those light blue. So while we're down here, we could just make a light blue dot next to the word oligodendrocyte. Now, oligo is Greek for few. So in politics, an oligarchy is rule by a few people. Monarchy is rule by one. Oligarchy is ruled by a few people. So oligo means few. What is there a few of? Oligodendrocytes. So this guy is an oligodendrocyte, and so dendro means like tree branch. So he just has a few branches. And this one has 1, 2, 3, 4. So let's zoom in on that one in particular. I'll color that one first. So oligodendrocytes are the Schwann cells of the central nervous system. Schwann cells just look like that, right? They're just that little bundle. So you'd have four different cells. Here you have one cell providing all the padding, almost all, down this axon, and he's grabbing this one over here. So they're not limited to just one. They can grab more than one axon. But it's very similar to the Schwann cell. It helps to insulate the axon like the rubber coating on an electrical wire, so you don't get electricity leaking out. If you get electricity leaking out, it short circuits and your appliance doesn't work right, and or your brain doesn't work right. I'll go ahead and just make this whole cell light blue. You see how I'm kind of doing a little bit of shading? I'm going darker around the edges, and I'm kind of leaving this white in the middle here, kind of leaving it lighter. That provides just a little bit of a 3D effect there. So let's find some other oligodendrocytes. Here's one. Holding on to that last little section of this neuron. After I get done coloring this one, I think I'll show you a picture, like a photograph of one of these things. Okay, so what do these really look like? Well, here's another artist's rendition. That's kind of what we're drawing, right? So that one looks even more like spacey, futuristic-y kind of. Here is an image where they used fluorescent dye. You know, these yellowish things here, these would be, I guess, the axons. This would be our oligodendrocyte, and here's those little branches reaching out. But maybe the yellow is actually kind of these pads here. You maybe can't see the neuron very well, but that would be the soma, and this would be the extension. So he's just got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 that you can see. So let's see, where's another one? Right here. See my picture here, they alternate. So this guy's grabbing on the middle, and this one has the ends there. So there's a lot of cooperation that's going on amongst the cells, and that's generally true in brain tissue. There's an immense amount of cooperation. The cells are constantly communicating with each other. We'll see that there's about 6 different kinds of cells that are working together, and that's not counting all the cells in the blood vessels and things. They're all cooperating. And their main goal is to help the neurons do their job. That's kind of like their main focus, is to keep the neurons healthy, keep these little synapse things in place, make sure the neuron has plenty of oxygen, food, get rid of the wastes, protect it from bacteria, things like that. Okay, so these are all something else. Let's see, there's a little bit of a oligodendrocyte peeking in here. Can't really see the axon in between there. Should have left a bigger gap, but there should be a little bit of axon there showing. Okay, and I think that's it for the oligodendrocytes. Okay, so again, their main job is simply to protect those axons and make sure that they're insulated. They are the Schwann cells of the brain. Next, we're going to do these little small ones that are kind of wedged in between here. These are called astrocytes. And let me show you a real picture. So you can see, you know, how somebody kind of thought these looked sort of like stars, twinkly stars there. And this is one of those fluorescent dye pictures. And the green things are the astrocytes there. That one really is looking like an asterisk down there. And I think the pink things are the nuclei. So that is an astrocyte. And their job is to keep everything in place. They're the spacers, the padding. And also, they help nourish the neurons. See, they're touching the neurons here. So they are going to transmit things through their cell wall here. They're going to relay oxygen, pick up carbon dioxide, pass along glucose. So they're kind of like the nannies of the brain, taking care of all the neuron kids, getting them all their meals, cleaning up after them. And they keep everything in place. So if you had this network forming, all these little connections, and of course this is where everything happens, your memory, your learning, your ability to move your muscles, your coordination, everything is dependent on these little connections. So if you didn't have these things keeping in place, you'd like jump up and down a little bit, wiggle your head, and all these things would go wiggle, 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 and they would come apart, and you'd like forget and not be able to do anything. So these astrocytes hold everything tightly in place so that when you do your sports activities, or if you fall and you hit your head, all your neurons stay in place. Okay, then I'll slide down here. There's one on the bottom. If I'm going too fast for you, just hit pause and catch up. Now, the nice thing about working in yellow is that you can be a little bit sloppy and it doesn't show too badly, since yellow is close to white. I think it's showing up worse here on the screen when I'm looking at it in real life. I'm not seeing those little white spots very much. So hopefully you're noticing the same thing as you're working. You can just go a little more quickly with the yellow than with the other colors. Now notice how this astrocyte and this astrocyte are touching. We're going to color red in a minute. This is a blood vessel, actually a capillary, small blood vessel. See, this is a blood cell. And it's touching like this, and it's going to be picking up things. It can pick up nutrients or oxygen. Right through here, these endothelial cells are very good at passing things right through the wall. Because remember, this is tight. Okay, there are like a little gap. This is where the cells come together. And sometimes they come apart. But basically in the brain, it never comes apart. In the brain, nothing really is supposed to ever leak out of the capillaries. Blood should never get out. And other little particles should never leak out. The way they get out is just going right through the cell wall and into this cell, and then this one can transfer it over to here, right? And it can touch here, and it can go through here and then into the axon. So up here we'd have some, now these aren't touching capillaries, so let's see here, this one would be touching, this one's touching a capillary. This is touching another cell, is touching a capillary, and then this one is touching the cell body. So the nutrients will come out of the blood vessel through here and over in like this. And that's how the neuron gets nourished, is through other cells. So it's very significant that a few of this guy's arms are touching the capillary and a few of the little arms are touching the neuron. Here's another one that's feeding the cell body area, touching the capillary and then transferring it to the soma. And this one is also doing an important job right here. Again, this is a very important connection going on. This is where an electrical signal is going, well, it's actually going to jump the gap here, but it's going to be transferred from one neuron to another. And we need to make sure this connection is very stable and tight. See over here, we've got an astrocyte. And down here, we've got one peeking in from the left part here. And at the top, I think this is also an astrocyte. This would be holding this side. Now this one isn't connected yet to a terminal. This one's kind of waiting, but there might be a connection in the future. So it's got its padding ready to go there. These dendrites do grow and change over time. Especially when you're a baby, a young child, these dendrites are going crazy, making connections all over. So, but throughout your whole life, you lose connections. Sometimes these things are intentionally taken apart. You don't need them anymore. They're gotten rid of, and then new connections will be made throughout your whole life. Okay, I think that's all the astrocytes. And before we forget, go down here, it says astrocyte, make a little yellow dot. We have them color-coded. And then let's go right on to the next one. It says microglia. Let's put orange in front of microglia. Now, glia just means glue. So all of these cells, except for the neuron, they're all called neuroglia. These can all be called glial cells. That's their general term. But the microglia, we actually have the word glia in the name. So the microglia are these things here, these weird things. And let me show you a picture of some microglia. Here's one of these fluorescent dye pictures. They've been turned green. Now, I don't know why they're not called something with dendrites in the name, because they really look like branchy. I don't know why they don't call them, so that we have oligodendrocytes, why these aren't polydendrocytes or something like that, because they certainly look like they've got a lot of branches. And there's another similar picture. So let's make these orange, and I'll tell you what they are as we go along. These are cells we actually met very briefly. If you remember back when we were talking about immune cells, and we were discussing macrophages, and we said that there's macrophages present everywhere in the body, and sometimes they look a little different, and then they have different names. So this is one of those places. the microglia are basically the macrophages of the brain. Now, macrophages and the rest of the body don't ever look like this. This structure is unique to the central nervous system. And this is what they look like when they're not active, when they're just kind of taking it easy, cruising around, and they're not actively eating, because remember, a macrophage is a big eater. Now, I've read that these things have been observed going around the brain tissue. They kind of like have a territory that they guard. And they go around and tap. They would go. Now, I haven't seen this. I've just read descriptions. But they use the word tapping, like inspecting. They would go around and they would constantly inspect things like this. And so this one would move around. He could move all over. They're like little amoebas. Now, this guy is stuck in place. The blue ones, the yellow ones here, they're not going anywhere. Their job is to stay put. These things, though, can travel all over. So, you know, this one could just slowly creep anywhere around here. And what they're really on the lookout for is invaders. Bacteria, viruses. Fortunately, they rarely get out. The barrier is so tight here. You've got these cells and you've got the endothelial cells forming a very, very tight barrier. The crack is pretty much non-existent. And so things rarely leak out. But if something did leak out, it would have to face these odd-looking macrophages, the microglia. And they would gobble up anything that gets out of the bloodstream. So let's do this one too. And there's one other, no, there's two others peeking in up here. Now, once these guys find something, should something leak out and they have something to eat, obviously this shape doesn't look very likely for being able to gobble up a whole bunch of stuff. This is, you know, pretty skinny. So the first thing that happens is they begin to change their shape. And they can do that. Actually, they're described as an amoeba-like cell. And amoebas are those little protozoa things that can change their shape. They can ooze around and assume just about any shape. So, amoeba means shape-changing, means changeable. So, can you see on this page two likely candidates for microglia that have changed into eaters? I left a clue on the cell. You can see a little bit of these skinny little things left on each of them. So one is here, and the other one is hiding behind here, behind that little bit of axon. So we're going to color them orange, so that at a glance, you know that everything orange is microglia. So even though these don't look the same as the others, you know that in fact they are the same cell. In fact, this one here, you see how it's just about to do phagocytosis? I gave it a little tiny virus or bacteria or something to eat. A little invader. little pathogen to eat up. These guys are so efficient. Brain infections are extremely rare. I mean, they do happen. It's not completely impossible, but they're very rare. Very rare indeed, fortunately. Part of the reason is because these guys are so good at doing their job. The other reason is that these guys are good at doing their job. I just found another picture of microglia. This would be its least active form right here, where it's the skinniest. It doesn't have very much of a dot in the center. And then it gets more active. You can see the blob in the middle gets a little bigger and a little bigger and a little bigger until it ends up looking like this, which is the most like macrophages in the rest of the body. They look more blobby like that. And then as it would become inactive again, it would start to shrink and go back to its branchy form. And here's somebody's drawing, if you can see that. That's not a photograph, that's a drawing showing its inactive form. Now the microglia are the only immune cells in the brain. In the rest of the body you have the B cells, the T cells, the neutrophils, macrophages, the basophils, eosinophils, all those different cells all cooperating together. Here you have microglia, that's it. So they have to take care of everything. Now let's do the next one on the list right here, the ependymal cells. And I'm going to use pink for the ependymal cells. And it says secrete fluid into ventricles. The ependymal cells are up here, and this space is part of a ventricle. Now, when we get to the brain, you'll learn a lot more about ventricles. Right now, you just need to know that the brain has some empty places. So little pockets of fluid called ventricles. So if you have an even lighter blue, or if you can just color very, very lightly with your light blue, or you can use another color if you want to, or you can use no color. You can just leave this white if you want to. Indicate that this is our ventricle, our fluid-filled space. So the fluid serves to help cushion things. It also provides some extra flow of nutrients and getting rid of wastes. And if you want to label that ventricle, you can, or you can just leave it unlabeled. And let's make these cells pink. And at the top of each cell, you're going to make some cilia sticking off. These are ciliated cells. Remember, we saw the cilia on the cells in the trachea, the columnar ciliated epithelium. So maybe these cells are somewhat related to those ciliated epithelial. I don't know, but they're not classified as epithelial. Like, if you look them up in a textbook, they're classified as neuroglia. Glial cells are helping cells in the brain. Everything that's not a neuron is a glial cell. So this would be a type of glial cell. And the ependymal cell's job is to line all the edges of these ventricles, these empty places. They're the lining on the inside, and they secrete the fluid. They actually make the fluid that fills the ventricle. Now, where would they get the water? Well, they're going to have to get it ultimately from the water you drink, and that has to go to your stomach, out to your digestive system, into your blood, and it would come in through here and be somehow passed along to these cells, and then they would put it into the space here. They would secrete it into that space. And then the cilia are there so that it can kind of move the fluid. The fluid can get swished around. This is particularly important in areas of the brain and spine where the fluid needs to move along and down. If the fluid just sat all the time, that wouldn't be so healthy. You flush the old fluid out and bring new fluid in. You're constantly flushing. And it is kind of like a cleaning system, bringing the fresh in. So the fresh fluid comes out of these cells and goes into here, and then eventually this will get drained out and down and into the spinal cord. Here they are. Of course, they're stained pink with some stain. You can see the cilia, though, along here. So this would be the ventricle out here, and this would be the brain tissue down here. Like in our picture, we kind of did a section like that right up in this corner. And there's another picture. This would be the ventricle right here. And this would be the ciliated edge along here. Okay, so over to this. Now we're going to tackle the capillary. So the first thing let's start with the easy thing. You see that erythrocyte in there? Okay, right, this is the red blood cell. We don't really have to say much about that because we've already studied it. And its main job is to bring oxygen to the brain, and the brain uses a lot of oxygen. It's probably the biggest user of oxygen and food in your body. Okay, and then make sure down here, it's erythrocyte, red. Let's also make the endothelial cells red. Let's do two things that are red. They're related. I couldn't think of a better color for these. Okay, so here are your pancake cells. Go really, really lightly. And I did not really indicate along here, you know, where the little pancake lines are, because it would just make it too complicated. But you can see here in the cross section that these cells are very thin, except for the nucleus bulges out a little bit. And then let's just make the blood vessel red. That'll help us see what's what. You can shade a little bit, make it a little darker along the outsides. And this cell here, we're going to talk about that last in just a minute. This is a pericyte, so you want to not color that. There's a little bit of capillary showing through here and here. That cell kind of looks like a spider hanging on, doesn't it? It's kind of a weird cell you don't hear about very much. Okay, so once again, the capillaries in the brain keep everything inside, basically, except for tiny nutrients that can leak out right through the cells and into these other cells, so basically nothing gets out. So if there's little pathogens floating through the bloodstream, they will hopefully not be allowed to exit. So the rest of the body is relatively leaky in comparison. The capillaries are often leaking. We saw that. In fact, the histamine, right, causes the capillaries to dilate and leak. Well, we really wouldn't want that going on here. So that whole inflammatory system and everything, that's like a disaster in the brain. You really don't want that going on. You got these microglia to take care of it, and you want no inflammation. Now, here's an optional bit of coloring. You can leave it just like this, or you can shade. Let me show you my sample that I'm working from. If you want to do something like this with a little bit of black, you can. If you'd rather not, you can skip it. I'll leave that up to you. But if you'd like to shade a little bit, you can You cannot do that. I think I'll just go on, talk about these purple things. These are pericytes. You can go down here. So there's the word pericyte. I'm going to make mine purple, light purple. Now, don't confuse the word pericyte with the word parasite. P-A-R-A-S-I-T-E. A parasite is a little thing living in your body that you don't want living in your body. So this is a pericyte, P-E-R-I, and there's that peri again, which means around the outside. And so you can see why this is called a pericyte. It's an around the outside cell because it wraps around these little capillaries. So when you say it, you can say very carefully, pericyte. So we know we're not talking about a parasite, because you might think, oh, that's a little animal holding on to it. It's a little, like I said, spider or something. So if I call it a parasite and it looks like a little spider, you get the wrong impression. This is a pericyte. So it wraps around the capillaries, and it helps to regulate blood flow. And it also helps to regulate things going in and out, mainly keeping things in. And between the two of these, between the pericyte and these endothelial cells, the barrier is so good and so tight. We have a name for it. We actually talk about it as the blood-brain barrier. So here's the blood, and this is the brain, and these two cells, the red and the purple, make the barrier. So the BBB, the blood-brain barrier, is basically the endothelial cells working with the pericytes to not let anything get out. Here's an illustration about pericytes. Now, here we have the end of a capillary, and these things are the kind of feet of astrocytes sticking on there. Remember, we said the astrocyte is responsible for getting nourishment to the neurons. So here's the astrocyte's little pads sticking to here, getting nourishment, and it'll send it over to the neurons. So here's the endothelial cells. Actually, it just looks like one. There's the nucleus wrapped around here. And this being the pericyte, and it looks like it's like underneath this covering here. You can't see the whole pericyte. And this says BM, and that would be basement membrane. You remember that these are epithelial cells, and all epithelial cells have basement membrane on the underside. So this is actually the top facing the inside, and the bottom of the cell is out here. So this would be basement membrane. So the pericytes actually kind of hang on to that basement membrane. And so these would be the astrocytes pads, and this is the endothelial cell. That's the nucleus of the endothelial cell, and here's the pericyte. So it's not quite like the one that we drew. It's a little different. That's the problem with looking at a lot of illustrations. You think you understand, and you look at another one, it's like, wow, this doesn't look anything like what I just saw. But the truth is that it depends on how you're slicing it, how you're looking at it, and they're not all the same. Some are probably more spidery than others, so that one just isn't particularly spidery. Here is an actual photograph or micrograph showing the pericyte here. I guess that would be the nucleus. Here's the endothelial cell along here. That would be the nucleus of the endothelial. This big dark blob in the middle is labeled as red blood cell. So this would be the empty space or the lumen around it. And so the pericyte is kind of hanging on to one side in this picture. So I have one 3D picture. Well, it's actually a series of three, but they're all very similar. Okay, let's just look at the top one. So this would be the pericyte with the little arms. And in this picture, it does look like it has little extensions. And here's one. Here's another. They're all hanging on. There's one kind of sticking out from the bottom, wrapping its little arms around. And here's some kind of coming up from the bottom. There's one. Here's one. Here's one. they're all covering it. So in these pictures, it looks very spidery. But in this one, it doesn't look spidery at all. So actually, both are true. Both are actual photographs, micrographs, and it just depends on how you're looking at them. Now let's color this other pericyte here. And I'll mention one other thing about the blood-brain barrier. The fact that it's so good is good, and yet sometimes it's difficult for doctors to treat things that go wrong with the brain because of the blood-brain barrier. Because even medium-sized molecules can't get out, that can be an issue with antibiotics or other medicines that are medium-sized molecules, and the blood-brain barrier won't let them out. So what they do is they give another chemical, actually it's a harmless sugar, that they give along with the medicine to cause the blood-brain barrier to be a little bit leaky, just for a few days. You wouldn't want that long term, but just for a few days while the medicine gets in, they cause this to leak, to let it get out. And then, of course, after treatment, it seals up again. Okay, so the coloring is done, and if you want to review information about the different cells, you can print out the page of text that goes with this and read through it and make sure you've understood what each cell does. And then we'll go on in the next lesson to talk about what's going on here in these little connections, these synapses, and also about what's going on here with the electricity going down the axons.